Hey, Marcus, House with you here, and welcome back to another week of space news, kicking off with SpaceX's Starship development. We are watching history in the making here, and there have been a lot of updates to discuss. With the static fire completed, we should be ready for a flight early next week. We had the attempted full duration hot fire with some problems to talk about there for the space launch system. It may not be quite as bad as many of us initially thought. A Starlink launch breaking several new records for SpaceX, Virgin Orbit blasted into orbit with the LauncherOne Demo 2 mission, and to top all of that off, Rocket Lab's first flight for 2021 with another successful launch of the Electron rocket. What a week this has been.
Okay, Neil, we can see you coming down the ladder now.
Today, this video is kindly supported by Surfshark VPN. More information later about how you can get 83% off and 3 extra months for free on their awesome VPN. Jumping right now into Starship development news though, SN9 was aiming to provide a streamlined pad flow when compared to SN8. Now, after SN9's historic day of 3 static fires, observations were made concerning 2 of the firings, which appeared to show only 2 of the 3 engines were firing during the second and third tests. Elon Musk tweeted that the 2 engines need a slight repair, so they will be switched out. Now, John Krause tweeted here pictures of Raptor SN44, which was the first Raptor to be removed. SN46 was the next Raptor to be removed, and then both of these were transported to the build site, where they were loaded on a truck to be taken elsewhere. It was assumed that this would push SN9's launch date back by weeks. However, these fears were at least partially dismissed with 2 new Raptors being transported to the launch pad for swap out processing. Elon mentioned that they were making major improvements to ease the engine swap process, and it needs to only take a few hours at most. So after another impatient week watching attempted static fires from many of us, including myself, we finally saw a beautiful looking test on Friday. That should mean that the next milestone for SN9 is the flight itself, which we are hoping will be happening early next week. Now, something new was recently spotted by Mary at the old gas well site. This, we assume, is an air separation unit that separates air into liquid oxygen, argon, and liquid nitrogen. Now, this liquid oxygen can then be used to replenish the tank farm down the road to be used for Starship testing. The liquid nitrogen, on the other hand, can be used in a separate heat exchanger to liquefy natural gas from the original gas wells. This natural gas can then be purified on site into liquid methane. Now, these commodities including liquid oxygen, liquid methane, and liquid nitrogen can be either directly pumped through underground pipes to the tank farm or delivered by truck. This process will be very beneficial in the long term when SpaceX needs vast amounts of propellant if they want to end up doing multiple tests per day. To news at the construction site, 2 SN17 sections were spotted, including the common dome section and the middle liquid oxygen tank section. Furthermore, there is some pretty big news for the week with the first section of Super Heavy Booster number 2 now being spotted. This section is the forward dome and features some of the new hardware on top of the dome that we never saw on BN1. On top of that, we saw the introduction of SN18 with a thrust puck also being spotted. How crazy is that? The new SN7.2 test tank was rolled to the pad on Wednesday ahead of its own testing campaign, where it's going to undergo a cryogenic liquid nitrogen test and be tested to destruction, just like its 2 predecessors, SN7 and SN7.1. This is the very first tank to be built using the 3mm stainless steel instead of the current 4mm. That is a significant change that will drastically reduce the dry mass of the vehicle. It's going to be interesting to see how that test tank holds up with the pressure tests. We also had some interesting views after the old Mark 1 vessel was cut apart. Now, this we are looking at here is the inside of the nose section of Mark 1 with a bunch of COPVs packed in around the outer walls. Such a bizarre looking structure, almost looks like some kind of mad jellyfish. I must admit, I had no idea that they had packed all of this into the nose a little over a year ago now. Looking at the quality of all of the welding, it's quite funny looking back to think that this version was actually intending to fly, at least for a short amount of time. That was well before the problems to do with pressure testing were even determined to be a problem. Mark 1, of course, was the very first tank section to get some crazy attention from the public. Sometimes I think that the enthusiasm behind SpaceX's Starship project is a lot to do with seeing potential explosions along the way. I, for one, am hoping for a nice, ordinary flight and successful landing of SN9. Now we head into some pretty important news for the future of Starship. There are two new members in the SpaceX fleet called Phobos and Deimos, named after the two Mars moons. 6 months after Elon Musk revealed that SpaceX is building floating super heavy class spaceports for its next generation Starship rocket, the company has already purchased and begun converting two retired oil rigs. Now Jack Bayer here captured wonderful images of an oil rig in Brownsville. It was quickly determined that this oil rig and a twin ship in nearby Galveston were purchased by an undisclosed buyer for around $7 million in July of 2020. Michael Baylor here determined that the shell company Lone Star Mineral Development purchased the rigs. Now in the tweet replies, another user discovered that this company was directly connected to SpaceX's CFO, Brett Johnson, indisputably confirming that SpaceX was the new owner of both of these oil rigs. Just terrific insight there, and make sure you're following both Jack and Michael there on Twitter and supporting there where you can. Now, as it turns out, the renaming of the ships to the names of Mars' moons also subtly confirms that they are owned by SpaceX. Phobos and Deimos are very fitting names for these future Starship launch or landing platforms, given SpaceX's intense focus on building a sustainable city on Mars. While SpaceX is currently building a land-based launch platform at Boca Chica, vast floating launch and landing platforms have also featured in SpaceX's official artist concepts of the rocket for several years. Now, this will enable airline-style Starship flights to and from coastal cities where sea-based platforms would be a necessity to avoid domestic regulations and extreme noise pollution. Elon Musk has also positioned sea launch as a viable alternative or complement to land-based Starship launch operations. So yes, we really appreciate the incredible community that dives deep into finding out more detail on this information. Big thank you to NASA Space Flight and Boca Chica Gal, especially for also capturing so many of these new parts being delivered to the construction site. It gives Brendan here creating these diagram updates along with all of us a lot of information to determine where many of these segments fit into the construction process. We can see there the new BN2 already added, and thanks Brendan for keeping us all up to date here. Now, last week we talked a little about the header tanks and why they are so important, and I got a huge number of comments about this with arguments that the fuel would actually be floating in almost a zero gravity situation while the vessel was in free fall before the flip. Thanks everyone for the debates and comments on this. It's great to see so many interested in the topic, but here is the thing though, the fuel is not floating in zero gravity. Remember that the whole point of the belly flop is to increase drag and lower terminal velocity as much as possible. Therefore, the vessel is slowing down a lot due to the thick atmosphere. Inside the ship, there is no such air resistance, so for that reason, the fuel is indeed being pulled downwards to slosh around the belly of the beast. For extra points though, if anyone would like to tell me in the comments how much gravity the fuel is roughly experiencing inside the ship relative to the Starship body itself throughout the skydive section of the flight, I'd love to see what you think. Huge thank you as well for all of your wonderful comments and likes around that area of the video. That means a whole lot. We put out these videos every weekend, so thanks for all of the subscriptions and interactivity from you all. You guys are just amazing. Another exciting Starlink launch this week, and it looks like 2021 is going to be quite a busy one for SpaceX with even more Starlink launches planned. On Wednesday the 20th, we saw yet another Starlink liftoff with the Falcon 9 from Pad 39A here at Kennedy Space Center in Florida. Some interesting records here have been broken with this mission. There we see it launching there off the pad, a beautiful clear morning as we witness the Falcon 9 screaming through the lower atmosphere, pushing right through Max-Q around 70 seconds into the flight. Shortly after, we saw the main engine cutoff and stage separation with the first stage heading back to land on the autonomous drone ship Just Read the Instructions. This was an incredible landing achieved in high winds and rough seas. SpaceX really pushed the boundaries with this one and even mentioned in the live stream that this was going to be a risky landing attempt. SpaceX are making it look too easy at this point as they hit the bullseye there perfectly. An incredible new achievement with the first successful 8th recovery of the same Falcon 9 booster and the 72nd recovery in total. Yep, this is the record breaker, people, and another terrific reuse is coming up here with this booster very soon. Its first ever flight was for the Crew Dragon Demo 1 mission, and it's now also shot up 5 separate Starlink missions with the other 2 launches for both a RadarSat mission and the Sirius XM mission. What an incredible set of launches this booster has experienced. The turnaround between successive launches was impressive as well, given that this booster flew just last month on December 13th for the Sirius XM mission. This makes it the fastest booster turnaround to date at just 38 days. The previous fastest, I believe, was just over 50 days, so quite a big jump there. SpaceX also mentioned that they have expanded their beta program, which is now being rolled out into areas of the United Kingdom. So exciting news there as well. When can we see that in Australia, SpaceX? Just asking for a friend, you know. Now, I think it's worth touching on the beautiful segment SpaceX shared before the flight, talking about the impact Starlink is having in some of these first communities that have suffered with poor internet connectivity for so long. Fast, reliable internet isn't just a luxury these days, it is a real need for these communities. It doesn't matter if it's health, education, police services, you name it. SpaceX is super proud to be involved in helping out these communities, and it just goes to show how Starlink really is going to change the world for these regions. I highly recommend going and watching this segment if you missed it from SpaceX's live stream. Now, California's Mojave Desert and Spaceport this week was a hive of activity, with ground crews attending a pre-flight and launch for LauncherOne's Demo 2 on January the 17th. This was an exciting mission, and we'll dive into that shortly, but first, this video has been sponsored by Surfshark VPN, who have been kindly supporting this channel now for well over a year. That has been extremely beneficial for the content quality, and it is a super awesome product as well. A VPN, or virtual private network, allows you the potential to truly open up the internet. Have you chewed through all of the available content that you want to watch from libraries within your country? Well, with Surfshark VPN, you can quite literally open up a world of new content to watch that has been previously locked from you. You just switch the country in the VPN settings here, and that's it. Open up your browser, and you now appear to be surfing from that location and have access to brand new libraries. I think the internet should be an open hub of knowledge where absolutely possible, and by using Surfshark VPN, you can take control of your online security and visibility. You can protect your data from those around you who may have very different personal views or values, and also from internet service providers. If you would like to support my channel here and are also considering a VPN or changing your existing VPN, head over to surfshark.deals/Marcus to get 83% off and 3 extra months for free. That is an incredible saving, and you also get a 30-day money-back guarantee, so you can try it out risk-free. The link is in the description below. So yes, this second demonstration mission for Virgin Orbit was aiming to not only attain orbit, but also release 10 CubeSats. This type of launch system is more tailored to precise orbital placement for these small satellites, as opposed to rideshare scenarios such as the Falcon 9, where the orbit is targeted for the bigger payloads themselves. The 70-foot long, or 21-meter two-stage launch vehicle, was fastened to the left wing of Cosmic Girl, which is the Boeing 747 that would help write a new chapter in history for Virgin Orbit. Rolling down the runway just before 2 p.m. and heading to the launch altitude of approximately 35,000 feet, or 10,700 meters, we saw Cosmic Girl commence her pitch up and bank hard to the right, timed beautifully with the Launcher One release. The Newton 3 engine came to life, and LauncherOne was on its way thanks to the swift 3-minute burn time. This first milestone passed the previous Demo 1 flight, which unfortunately saw a propellant line rupture and the loss of that launch vehicle. With stage separation also successful, the upper stage Newton 4 engine lifted LauncherOne and its payload into its orbit. Now, there was around a 45-minute coast and another burn of the second stage engine prior to release of the 10 CubeSats from a mix of university groups as well as NASA's Ames Research Center. With jubilant scenes back on the ground with the arrival of the launch crew and pilots here, we can now look forward to Virgin Orbit moving to commercial operations in the near future and competing with other small satellite launch providers such as Rocket Lab. But let's not forget, we also have coming Astra, Relativity Space, and Firefly Aerospace, all hot on the heels of Virgin Orbit as well, as they all seek to make their mark on the small satellite launch market. I think it's useful to do a few comparisons here. The maximum payload for Launcher One is approximately 300 kilograms into a 500 kilometer sun synchronous orbit. To compare that with Rocket Lab's Electron, the maximum payload shown on the Rocket Lab website is also 300 kilograms for the exact same type of orbit. Fairly evenly matched there, but of course, Launcher One here has the benefit of being able to fly around bad weather at different locations. It's worth noting as well that Rocket Lab are trying to reuse its Electron booster, which would still likely make it a more cost-effective flight. It is so great to see that the small satellite launch market is rapidly growing. We are really witnessing the future here. Speaking of Rocket Lab, they have just this week had their very first launch of 2021, lifting off on January the 20th from New Zealand. The mission name chosen for this one was pretty fun, with it being named Another One Leaves the Crust. This dedicated mission for OHB Group saw the communications microsatellite put into a polar low Earth orbit on this, the 18th mission for Rocket Lab. This will hopefully be the start of more rapid launch frequency for this year for Rocket Lab. In keeping with the vision of Rocket Lab to produce a rapid launch service, it's worth highlighting that it was just 6 months ago that OHB Group signed the launch contract with Rocket Lab in the first place. The launch countdown went into a hold for a short duration due to excessive ground winds, giving time to take in the nice sunset, but finally the timer resumed and we saw the liftoff of the very first of many Electron launches for 2021. After successful first stage separation and fairing deployment, the payload was eventually delivered to orbit by the kick stage as planned, but this event was sadly not shown. A wonderful start to the year there for Rocket Lab. Now, last week on Saturday the 16th, we saw four RS-25 Space Shuttle main engines roar to life on the Space Launch System Artemis 1 core stage, sadly with a premature shutdown at around T plus 67 seconds. This final test did come with a few challenges, but to start off with a good note, all the hardware for the core stage is in excellent condition with no major issues noted. That sure is a relief for the entire program. Now, looking back to the test, it was prematurely shut down due to conservative parameters for the stage in order to ensure the safety of the vehicle above all else. For context, each engine has one hydraulic system associated to it in order to perform thrust vectoring and gimbal control. Now, each of these hydraulic systems has a CAPU, or core stage auxiliary power unit, to power it up. Now, engine 2, or its official name E2056, shut off in unison with the other engines directly after identifying the issue, that being that the tolerances set for the hydraulic system through the CAPU were being exceeded. Now, in flight, this wouldn't have made much of a difference, as the hydraulic systems on the gimbal mounts are cross-linked and could have compensated for the loss of one of the engine CAPUs without any problems. However, since the core stage is being tested on the ground at Stennis, tighter tolerances are put in place in order to stress the system as much as possible and identify all points where it could fail in flight. Now, allowing for these extra levels of safety checks and higher levels of tolerances only benefits the program when it comes to human safety overall. NASA officially have said that they have gotten much of the needed data points filled. However, another test is becoming more and more likely. This test would probably happen in mid to late February and would repeat the entire Hotfire countdown, but this time for a full 8 minutes. It's definitely great to see that the core stage is in one piece with no required refurbishment needed before the next Hotfire. So, what do you think? Was it great to see those RS-25s fire up together once again? I tell you, it is just such a nostalgic feeling watching these engines come back to life, knowing that they are going to take flight once again. It's a little sad at the same time knowing that we'll be seeing them getting thrown into the ocean, but at least they will have had the opportunity to show off their might a few more times. Now, remember, we also have an incredible SpaceX mission coming up shortly with Transporter 1. That could very well mean a new record for the most satellites ever launched in a single flight, including a unique deployment of 10 Starlink satellites into a polar orbit this time for the very first time. We'll cover that one in more detail in the next video. This is an exciting one. So yes, what an action-packed week of space news we've had right there. We'll be back for another week next weekend. As always, a big thank you to the amazing patrons and YouTube members here for not only their support of the channel, but also for their contributions and information and discussions that they provide each week. There is no way that we can continue creating content at this quality and frequency without all of that incredible support. And also, that allows us to increase the time that we can spend on these videos as well. It's all due to the growing list of supporters. Thank you to each and every one of you. As support increases, that just helps the entire team. So if you like what we're doing and you'd like to join our awesome patrons here, head to patreon.com/marcushouse, or alternatively, you can join up as a YouTube member now. That gives you access to interact with me more directly via the roles on our Discord server. You can have your names listed right here, like all of these other amazing people, and you can also have earlier access to videos to watch before anyone else. A massive thank you as well, especially to the production crew assisting greatly with the video production here, and of course to the quality control squad for helping me research and proof the material for these videos. If you're interested in these topics and you'd like to be a part of it, follow me on Twitter and please do get in touch. In the tile in the bottom left today, we have my video last week talking Starship, the return of SpaceX's CRS-21 mission, Blue Origin's NS-14 mission, and loads more. In the top right is my latest video, and in the bottom right, content that YouTubers selected from my channel just for you. Thank you everyone for watching, and we'll see you all in the next video.